Welcome back. On today's agenda is an accidental yet profound scientific discovery. It all began in 1948 when Norton Zinder arrived at the University of Wisconsin-Madison to join Joshua Lederberg's laboratory as a fresh graduate. 2 years prior to his arrival, Lederberg and Tatum had discovered that conjugation was the mechanism of genetic transfer in E. coli. Zinder's task was now to help build upon this discovery and investigate whether conjugation was E. coli specific or if it also occurred in other bacteria. They started off by looking for conjugation in Salmonella Typhimurium. What they found instead was entertainment. Well, we can't call it that now because they ended up naming the phenomena transduction. But yes, entertainment was up there on the suggestions list. Okay, let's cut to the chase. So they began by using UV radiation to create doubly auxotrophic mutant strains, which lacked the ability to synthesize two different amino acids. Then they isolated these strains on minimal media using penicillin. Penicillin interferes with the synthesis of new peptidoglycan cell walls by blocking the activity of the transpeptidase enzyme in growing bacteria. This causes osmotic lyse of the bacterial cells. However, since mutant strains cannot grow on minimal media and therefore aren't synthesizing any peptidoglycan cell walls, penicillin is unable to target them. Hence, they survive. Next, they cultured pairs of these isolated mutants with complementary nutritional requirements and found that the only cross showing above background level prototrophs was that between the parental strain labeled LT2, which was auxotrophic for methionine and histidine, and LT22, which was auxotrophic for tryptophan, phenylalanine, and also tyrosine, as phenylalanine is a precursor for tyrosine synthesis. To confirm if these prototrophs were arising through cell-to-cell contact, which is necessary for conjugative transfer, they set up a U-tube experiment. The two strains were cultured in minimal growth media inside the separate arms of the tube. At the bottom of the tube was a glass filter with a very small pore size, which prevented bacteria from passing through. During the experiment, the growth medium was flushed from side to side, and after the cells had grown to saturation, they were plated out on minimal agar. If it was conjugation that elicited the prototrophs earlier, then the formation of colonies was not expected now, as the two strains had been separated in the U-tube by the glass filter. However, a small number of colonies did arise from the LT22 side of the U-tube. From this, it was clear that cell-to-cell contact was not being required. So what was going on then, and why were they only seeing LT22 prototroph? Zinder and Lederberg hypothesized that this asymmetric transfer of genetic material was occurring via some filterable agent, or FA, that was being produced by LT2 under stimulation from the LT22, which then gave rise to LT22 prototrophs. It did cross their minds that perhaps it was transformation that was taking place, and the FA was simply free DNA fragments. However, this hypothesis was disproved when they added DNAs to the U-tube and saw that LT22 prototrophs were still being produced. Subsequent experiments then revealed that the chemical, physical, and genetic characteristics of the FA were similar to that of bacteriophage, that is, viruses that infect bacteria. It later became clear that LT22 was lysogenic for a bacteriophage now called P22. That is, P22 could infect LT22 and incorporate its genome into the LT22 DNA to silently replicate along with it until the bacteria experienced some sort of stress. Therefore, some of the LT22 cells being used in this experiment must have harbored a P22 infection. And when the bacterial cells were subjected to UV radiation, and perhaps due to the lack of nutrition available to the mutant strains, the phage genome excised from the LT22 DNA and entered the lytic cycle, whereby it overtook the cell's replication machinery and assembled new phage particles, or virions, which eventually caused cell lysis. Some of these virions then crossed the filter and subsequently infected LT2 cells. P22 is mostly lytic towards LT2. Thus, after causing LT2 cell lysis, new virions returned through the filter to infect intact LT22 cells. Since LT22 is lysogenic for the phage, it underwent recombination. One thing I didn't mention is that when the phage overtakes the host cell machinery during the lytic cycle, it firstly creates nucleases which begin hydrolyzing the bacterial DNA into fragments. What ends up happening is that around 1 in 10,000 phage accidentally package some of these fragments along with their own genome. So among the virions that accidentally packaged LT2 genes, there were some that incorporated the wild-type genes required for the synthesis of tryptophan, phenylalanine, and tyrosine. Because remember, LT2 could synthesize all amino acids, just not methionine and histidine. When such virions then infected LT22 and underwent recombination, auxotrophy was reversed and prototrophy restored. The discovery of transduction created new avenues for genetic engineering and modern biotechnology. Around 2 decades after Zinder and Lederberg published their findings, scientists had discovered how to use viruses to insert DNA fragments with known sequences and functions into bacterial genome. And during the 1990s, viral vectors isolated from human tissue were used to deliver healthy genes into cells lacking them. This formed the basis of gene therapy, which, although is a field still currently under research, holds the potential for treating various diseases and cancers.